Yeah, me shit. Oh, yeah, you're going to see me? All right. Would you rather have a picture for your desk instead?
Yes, but I'm used to being under the cabinet, not behind the cabinet.
You're letting us talk to people, really. You're letting us really talk to
people. It was appropriate.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one thing I didn't mention is that there are associate CIO left during the middle of this, before the end of the project, too.
It's true.
Yeah. What we're going to do is we'll put a picture of Chuck back to one of the aliens.
Yeah. In the background?
Yeah. Oh, my. Money's flying.
Came for the soundtrack. That's cool.
Yeah. It's all right. You ready? Start rolling. All right. I'll wait for your sign. Thank you, Randy Bachman. I mean, thank you, Brian Myers, for that audio thing. Welcome, everybody, to our presentation for Northwest Met 2018 here in beautiful Corvallis. I am exceptionally happy that so many of you are here today on what is probably the nicest weather day we have had in the Northwest, at least in the Oregon area now for, I would say, 4 months?
4 months.
Yeah, 4 months or more, fair to say. Yeah, so today we're going to talk about a project and a series of projects that we've been working on at Portland State University, major building projects. Historically, we've never done too much in a very intense short period of time, but this is the first of four major projects at Portland State, so I've got a lot of material now going forward, I think, to present at Northwest Met's and CCUMC's going forward for the next few years. And this is the first kickoff of many. Portland State University is taking a new direction. It's the direction of we want to be vibrant, we want to be alive, we want to be an exciting campus with lots of new buildings, opportunities for students, and really engage a combination of what is considered architecture that is inviting and good, combined with good technology choices that will work for us. So with that, we're going to talk about taking care of business, which is essentially the Karl Miller story at Portland State University. So the Karl Miller Center established in 2017. Some of us in this room walk by this building every day and saw the transformation occurring over a three-year period, but it's longer than that. This story starts in 1979. This story starts back at a time when building a building was building a building and not thinking too much about students' needs and about classrooms and faculty spaces and students' study spaces and active learning spaces. For us, this was the opportunity at Portland State to really capitalize on something we could actually wrap our heads around as a university and then join forces to do something that would really improve a space that historically wasn't that great a space. So before, School of Business Administration, Brian, do you have a few words to describe this building that you would say?
You can see kind of from the picture as opposed to the previous one, the building wasn't very inviting. There weren't a lot of windows. Most of the offices had half to quarter windows, if anything. It was very labyrinthian is the term I'd like to use on the interior. Not a lot of space concerned for group work, study work. It was really just offices and a handful of classrooms for the most part for the School of Business as well as for the School of Education.
Yeah, It was a space we considered kind of dark, dank, very uninviting, and like, oh, do I have to go over there to help? There was really only one general access classroom in the whole space, School of Business 190, but it was set up, it was an awkward classroom too. It wasn't a very good classroom. It had a stage that you couldn't really teach off of because the screen was right directly behind you because you would be blocking the screen the whole time. We finally moved technology down to the floor in front of the classroom, and it was better, but it still was awkward. It was an odd slope. There were security problems in the space. It had an old 16-millimeter projection booth. A lot of the things that you would inherit in a classroom in that space. That was the only general access classroom. Other classrooms were departmental classrooms where it was as if they had watched television episodes of the TV show Paper Chase in the creation of these classrooms around the building that basically were like
mini bullpens.
Yeah, mini bullpens where an instructor would be in a pulpit and there'd be students around the edges and up front. And it's like, that was a little awkward. I think we have a few more pictures here. As you can see, not a lot of light getting into the space and a lot of bricks. And it just a very not a particularly wonderful space at the PSU campus. So we begin. Brian, we found a video online we'd like to show you. Brian? So we'll talk over this a little bit. This is what happened to our beloved skybridge.
Half the block that it was on was just a skybridge. So in order to give us a lot more square footage over the area, the first thing to go was the skybridge. So we found this cool little video.
Yeah. It was interesting, the space where you see the crane working here, I always referred to that as the grassy knoll, because it always was a nice green space right here where summertime, nice weather day like today, there would be 15, 20 students. They'd be hanging out there in the grass, just sitting there and just enjoying themselves, just a place to chill between two big buildings. And you still get the traffic. We got the max there. So, yeah, so it was a change for us to see a project of this nature happening on campus. And it did cause a lot to ponder. Oh, we have a green spot. We're losing it. Well, what we got in exchange for that piece of grass, I think, is already paid off in the few short months since we opened September. I think that the amount of things that have happened, we'll talk a little bit more about that. So, Brian, if you could, next slide. So, a little bit of the background. So, formally, we called this the School of Business Administration / Education, because it was a shared space where the School of Ed there. You know, in doing a little research for this project, I found out a little bit more information. The building, like many buildings at Portland State University, were built in phases. And that was in two and like. So between this 10-year period of 79 and 89, the building was built in two pieces, two halves. It's pretty hard to show where exactly that is. I can go to the Neuberger Hall project now, and I know exactly where this is where the old one ended, this one, the new one began. And that was the type of project. So that was probably had a lot to do with funding, a lot to do with availability of funds to do things. They probably wanted to do it all at once, but they probably had to do it in sections. As we were saying, a few windows, very uninviting. No place at all in this old building for students to gather in any way. There was a little entryway in the very front by the classroom I mentioned, 190, where you'd occasionally find students working, but no type of team space, huddle space, nothing that we're expecting in any projects today that we're getting. It was just kind of like, oh, there's a chair. I'll sit there and get another chair, and I'll meet with my classmate, and we'll have a team meeting. That's about what happened. And because of the lack of these types of spaces and this, they actually were reaching out to our operation with our computer classrooms, trying to reserve our computer classrooms, which were, those aren't intended for team meetings. Those are intended for full classes to come in, use the computers and the projectors. But yet, though, the dean's office contacts the manager and says, can you help us out? And if they're available, we can do that. So we tried to do our level best with that. And once again, faculty offices and departmental spaces, very inadequate, not too unlike what the rest of the building described, a huge lack of data. The amount of data that were in there, I think maybe two. One was for phone, one was for the PC. People were asking for more data, and we're like, we don't have the ability to do that unless we do some massive renovation of the closet. So this became ramping up over the 90s as a huge problem. And then no retail space in the building or near the building. A few blocks away, yeah, but now the expectation is that whatever building you're in, there's a way to get coffee in it. There's some other ability to do something else. Well, this was a game changer for us because it allowed us to do something totally different. At the same time, you know, this is happening. Around it, we're getting our academic student rec center is built. Brand new building, 2009. Mm-hmm. We get more public transportation with the MAX line in downtown Portland. So we see the addition of the red line, or the green line, and the orange line, and the yellow line, and a variety of ways to get back and forth from public, using public transportation to Portland. The trolley car, too, was an addition that came on a little later, too. So all exciting changes that were happening around the campus and around this particular building. So funding. What paid for this? You know, that has been a huge issue now in the state of what pays for what we're doing. Where are we getting the money from? Is it coming from the state? Is it coming from students' pockets, the student tuition? Where is this money? Well, you know, because of the way this was funded, no student dollars, tuition dollars were used in this. And the designer, the construction, the design phase of this was very big, and also the construction phase was very big. But I can tell you this, that this is the type of project that I have dreamed of from an audiovisual project manager standpoint of that, wow, the money is coming from a source different than the state. It's state and tuition. It's coming from private donors, state-backed bonds that allow you to do a lot of nice things, then pay it back. And then $9 million gift from the Millers, and the Miller, Rick Miller now is our Board of Trustees chair for Portland State University, and a graduate of the university, and very passionate about Portland State University. So the amount of buy-in that this particular project got was significant. It was like everybody on hand, everybody on deck. Nobody saying, no, don't do that building, do this building instead. No, it was time, and everybody was on board. The leadership of our president at that time, Vim Vivelle, to lead this, got the inertia of everybody, the buy-in that would allow this to happen. So a little bit about Karl Miller. So Karl Miller is a guy. There is with the exception of the fact that his son is the board chair of our board, he was the type of parent who encouraged his kids to go to school, get education, embed yourself, make yourself better, and do whatever you can to improve your experiences and improve yourself and improve the world around you. And I saw at least two or three of the grand openings and meetings where I see Rick Miller. Rick Miller is, how tall would you say Rick Miller is, Emily? Yeah, he's one of the tallest humans I've ever seen, actually. He was emotional and very beside himself with feelings of that it was this man who allowed this to happen. This is his grandfather, I believe. Yeah, his grandfather. And the encouragement that he got in making this dream happen and the money. And he wanted to honor his grandfather with naming the building after him. So hence the Karl Miller Center. This statue is right off one of the doors, a new door that we never had before that's right across the street from Smith Center that makes access a whole lot easier because in the past, we had to take the Sky Bridge or walk all the way around to the other block. So, and it's in one of the better areas that's been lit up and nicely. So, you know, think about that in terms of your own parents. Think about how they've supported you and loved you and when you went off to colleges and universities or when your students off to college and universities, how that transcends and that 20 years later, 30 years later, how that matters. Because I think that's a real important story here on the Karl Miller Center. So who were the partners on this project? Talk a little bit about that because, you know, to do anything right or to do anything, you have to have your collective sets of partners and the people that are, you know, engaged in this major undertaking, and it was a major undertaking. So real quickly, I want to go through these. The PSU Capital Projects and Planning, they're the ones who we are assigned project managers and their teams, and they're the ones who are working with us, the entire group, on the project itself and moving it forward through the schedule, through the processes allowed. We were assigned a project manager from the Capital Projects team, and he worked with us, and my one word I said to him, I said, this will be a success, and I will not let it not be a success from the AV standpoint. PSU Office of Information Technology. Once again, now we're at the table, as any OIT unit within your major building projects have to be at the table, have the right players at the table at the right times to help make those decisions and to help do those different things that make it up. And very important is that our CIO was very, Kirk Kelly was very involved in this too by serving on the steering committee. And also the CIO now of Western Washington University, Chuck Lanham, also was on the steering committee. And we took a lot of our lead from their experiences on this project to help make it a success. PSU Office of International Affairs, they essentially became the occupant of the sixth floor of this building because pieces had to move fiscally to make it happen. There's a lot of surge move at PSU because of projects. And their critical surge move is they left their old-time space at East Hall to become the sixth floor resident. They very much needed a new space, too. So they were that add-on department college to help make this a reality. So from outside the university, I just want to highlight a couple of the other partners that we had. The project general contractor, Skanska. I can't say enough about them. At first, I was a little suspicious. You know, your general contractor, I don't know about these guys. Their amount of passion in the four or five people that resided at our university for 3 years and their amount of engagement was exceptional. And that was one of the things about the success. You have to have a good general contractor who really responds to all the other partners and all the other questions and all the other chaos that goes around. And I'll talk a little bit about chaos, too. You also have the partner SRG, Building Design and Look. We were assigned a person. Her name was Louise Foster. She was a wonderful person to work with. She engaged me, members of our AV team, members of the dean's office, the whole project, and good. And I was at the grand opening, and I turned to the architecture chair, Clive Knights. I go, Clive, what do you think of the building? He goes, it's pretty cool. I think my wife did a good job. And I go, your wife? He goes, yeah, I'm married to Louise Foster. And I'm like, I didn't know that. And this person, I've known Clive for 15 years, 16 years, and then, woof. I'm working directly with his wife for a three-year intense period on the design of this really critical, important building. So you also have a high-level architect, because when you see some of the pictures, you go, yeah, you guys did need a high-level architect for this. Forward-thinking, actually, it's a German company, and their ability to articulate what the needs were for this building were exceptionally awesome. This project, we were assigned a very good AV design consultant, Lucid Acoustics, a gentleman named Tobin Cooley here in the Northwest, and really enjoyed partnering with him. He took our classroom standards, and he helped make it a reality of what we were trying to do and what this project needed to look like. And he took what standards we had at the time, which were, you know, we could have been nicer than what they will be as soon as we get them redone, and said, yeah, we can make this happen. And then Delta AV, who was the primary AV integrator who we partnered with on the installation phase of the project, which happened in different periods of time because different parts of the building had to be delivered at different parts of the time because of the nature of the schedule. So all in all, this collection of individuals who made these teams up and stuff led to the huge success of this project. And it was there were times it was rough. You'll see that. But all in all, the level of commitment by these individuals was never wavering, and always everybody was focused and like kept their sense of humor on the worst days, and there were some bad days, and just kept rolling with it. Yeah. Oh. Got the box.
I was curious, whose decision was it, and the reasons behind going with a separate consultant instead of a design build type?
It came from the steering committee.
Okay.
SRG brought on Lucid Acoustics because they needed a specialist for AV because they realized there's a lot of AV on this project, so we have to get SRG to talk to PSU, OIT, ITS in terms of the audiovisual deliverables on this project, and I think that's one of the key pieces is that selection. I didn't get to select any of these people.
I just wondered.
And now going back, I'm like, I wish I would have been able to say I selected these people because we made up a good team. And that's one of the things that on this project, Gary, that really enforced me is that the commitment that happened and the relationships that got developed. I know Louise has left SRG. I saw her on campus because she still comes back to look at the Karl Miller Center. And I'm like, I miss you. I miss you too. And I hope we can work again sometime, and maybe we will. So, yeah, once again, it's the collective of people working together towards a common good. So some of the finances for the AV side, which I was able to basically manage the funds because I was told I have X amount of dollars for this. And my team worked with me. I have one individual, James Hatfield, who worked very intently on developing the AV packages and what the costs were associated with this. So this is a pretty accurate breakdown of where everything went. This was the amount of money that we were given for the project, $629,000. Nothing more, that's it. Do not exceed this number. So given that, we were able to create our standards and packages, some which got developed along the way because we had just done some really nice work in different areas to work with that. So I'll talk about those a little bit. First, our group study conference rooms. These are rooms where we had done some work for the library because we had done some group study huddle stations for them, but we weren't really quite happy. So James came up with a configuration of using some of the best of the best. And for that, that is a combination of the InFocus 65-inch J-Touch display, Extron Media ShareLink, Extron MLC.
Control.
Dell Octoplex micro form factor mini computer that kind of resides and hides a little bit behind it, chief mount. And we were able to replicate that to the tune of 22 of these group study classrooms. Initially, it was lower, but then later in the project, more funds appeared, and we did four more. So they put the infrastructure in the space for us, and they value engineered some of the equipment out, and then they value engineered it. They gave it back in. They put it back in. So we're able to do those a little bit later. We've got a dean's conference room that doesn't have a fancy touchscreen, but it has an 84-inch Panasonic, and that's pretty impressive. So they use that for displays also. Because of the amount of lights in this building, in those two styles of rooms, projection was not an option. There had to be some form of backlit display similar to this. Information displays, kind of a hot potato at Portland State University because everybody wants it, but they want to find somebody else to do their content for them. But it's like, no, we'll help you with the hardware pieces, and then you work on the content. There's a PC there for you. There's a display there for you. There's the necessary Extron pieces to turn it off at a certain time. Most of this equipment, if not all of it, lives on GVE, Extron GVE, so we monitor it that way. Then we also have the three global classrooms. That was something long in coming, because that was one of the first things that the dean's office was working with us on, is that they wanted to create essentially a video space where you can do anything in it. And anything could be lecture capture, Google Hangouts, Zoom, GoToMeeting webinar. So in the process of this, we looked at different pieces of equipment, and we came up with a configuration using some audio pieces of equipment, AV bridge matrix, and different types of interfaces where essentially a person can either produce from the podium on the PC, or they can have a laptop and here, sit in the back room and then produce it. So it became a bit of a Swiss Army knife type of way. I have seen it in the two and a half quarters we've been using it now. I've seen it used for Google Hangouts, and we've also successfully moved a transportation seminar that historically had used Echo 360 into that space, and they're to get the functionality they want of better Q&A, more interactivity. And we have a student production student sitting in the back of the room with a big laptop that used to be yours and producing the class. So we worked with the one of the individuals in the office who was very passionate about video production. You know, you try and find that individual within your university or your college who's like, I'm the video professor. I want to be on video. And sure enough, we worked with him in the beginning. And then he became the dean. So it worked out real well that way. And then we also have 20 general access technology classrooms. These are classrooms that are very much related to what our PSU standards are of class tech podiums, Panasonic projectors, daylight screens, Avid document cameras, Dell resident PCs. So very much what we do, but so there were some challenges with some of these rooms because this was our first really serious delve into laser projectors. And we were a little nervous about it, but we did it, and now we don't regret it because of the ability. The only thing we regret is that we returned $22,270 back to them because I could have probably spent more money on projectors to get brighter lumens because we have a lot of windows. So with that, hopefully we're getting closer to the pictures. So quickly, Brian, can you run through this part of it real quick?
All right, so like I was saying earlier, there was that huge green space that we were talking about. And so by using that to add another portion to the building, in addition to kind of taking the other old part of the building and tearing it down to studs and slabs, we were able to increase the square footage of the building by 172%, so almost doubled it. We got 23 classrooms out of it, whereas opposed to just, which is three times the amount of classrooms we had prior to the construction, we were able to create 22 team project group rooms, which didn't exist before at all. We've got new retail spaces on the ground floor. One of them's open now. Two of them are going to be open here pretty shortly. You'll see when you see, I can't really describe it. You kind of have to see the pictures. But and then part of the building that's really gorgeous, built out of wood and glass, where all the windows we're talking about. There's a huge five-story like study area, and there's a lot of inbuilt natural light. And there is not a day that goes by that area is not packed with students. There's a large open floor plan. There's kind of very strange stairwells, but it's open. The students are sitting there. They're studying. They've got stools. They've got tables. They're getting together. It's like it's the space that they've wanted it to be for so long. And finally, it's there. And it's got natural light. It's open. It's inviting. And it's always busy.
Yeah, one of the other things we were able to do is develop more better office space for faculty with more windows, more light, more spaces within embedded in their suites where they can meet as small teams with these office spaces and with displays and everything. So what we go over there and see one of the things that happened not too long in December or January, the building had been open for a month, InFocus was there, and dead week, our week before finals. We went around the building. Every space was in use, and they were using the equipment in the room, and they started popping their heads in there. Do you like this? And the students say, yeah, we like this. We like it a lot, because we never had anything like this before. So I think they really enjoyed the fact that, you know, there was attention to the students' needs, and they were met. One of the other things on a big building project like this, there's the LEED Platinum eligible facility aspect of it. We're trying to get LEED status. I'm sure we qualify that. I'm not sure if it's been awarded yet, but I'm sure we qualify for that. Also, we use this opportunity to create a very sophisticated boardroom for our dean's office, which is actually better than the other boardroom on campus. They used to the State of Oregon's Board of Trustees office, which we still use, but we bring in gear for every event we have over there. And it allowed us to do things. That was the last piece of the puzzle completed because of furniture and some other technical issues. Once again, it's a hub of activity on campus. It wasn't before. It was like running away from the building at place. There was not much going on there other than some classrooms, class offices. It was just kind of dank and disappointing. But now it's a hub. And we never had a hub. You think our hub would be our student union? No. Our hub now, I think, is the Karl Miller Center. We've got a tree. We got a suspended Alaskan yellow cedar spans from the third to the fifth floor, and you'll see some pictures of that, too. It's really close to a stairwell. One of the concerns they had is that people would be jumping on it and playing on it. Well, if they tried to do that, they probably would fall and hurt themselves pretty severely. And then on the very top of the building, because it's Portland, we want green spaces, there's some nice garden areas up there. And I've been up there a few times, and I'm like, on a day like today, I'm sure we'll go back to campus and they'll be packed. There'll be people up there studying, sleeping, just enjoying the beautiful day. Yeah?
On the LEED certification, were you guys asked to make any changes to your AV in regards to the LEED?
No. We weren't directed in any way to do anything differently than we had done. Be interesting if they come back and try and get some more points from us from some, but they know we use lasers, we used, you know, certain daylight screen surfaces. You know, you get points for all that type of stuff, and that's what I think. So I think they were keeping it pretty good close. So I'll bring up the first pictures here, and also, because some of you were in the Northwest, if you find yourself in Portland, very much would like you to come and see the building, because it's something I think we're all proud of who are associated with Portland State now. Brian?
All right, so that's that tree we're talking about here on the right.
Yeah.
And that's just kind of a look down from the top floor onto it. No one's jumped on it yet. And we just took some shots of the computer lab on the fifth floor. This is just one of two computer labs, the general school of business, but general access, anyone can use them on the fifth floor. And then just like we were saying, like even though this is on the fourth floor and there's classrooms all the way around, and you can see inside, so without having to like open the door, there's glass on both the wall facing inside of the building as well as glass on the outside to get natural light from both angles. So you can't really sit up against a wall per se. You're always sitting up against glass. And then all in these middle spaces, there's tables, there's chairs, there's benches. There's always just students hanging out there getting the space that they've been asking for so long there.
All right, just a few more pictures to show you. This is our atrium area. It can give you a little bit sense of what we did here between all the large stellars. This is where the grassy knoll is on the north side of the building. I think I'm looking at floors 1, 2, 3, 4. There's a fifth floor here somewhere up here.
It's the
fifth floor. So a lot of pictures on this. It's hard just to get the right picture with the right lens, but there's a lot of visuals here. There's an area here that is basically an atrium event area where there are events being held, which has a whole set of issues. I'll talk about that a little bit. But I can tell you this, there are times you did. We just did a team photo here, and that's actually the best spot for us of the day because it was pouring outside. Well, let's just go over there and have a team photo right there. And we did. It turned out great. That was good. Also, you know, I mentioned digital displays. Here's the one when you walk in the door on your left-hand side. I believe these are 2 55-inch displays. It started out, though, with just the one because this was so popular, somebody from the transportation office said, oh, can we put a transportation board up there, which we've already done. We did one at the Pizza Smitsa. We did one in the Sciences Building. So we were able, it took a little while, but we able to add one, and that's the MAX, and those the bus lines?
Yeah, MAX and then the bus lines.
Yeah, a couple of the bus lines that connect up downtown that they felt would be relevant to students. So it tells us the time of when a train or a trolley or a bus is going to arrive. So you could be there and go, shh, I got to go. So there. Also, this is the top level of here, giving an angle shot into the classrooms, pointing north, looking north. And it was just amazing as things got evolved and you started seeing people use the space. That was the most incredible thing for me because I had spent a lot of time in the space with the Delta AV, with the AV, with our team. And as it grew a little bit more, I'm like, this is awesome. This is what is supposed to happen. So once again, a beautiful shot there of downtown Portland on the roof. You can see the urban building here in the distance and coin tower and I believe the standard insurance there. Mm-hmm. And just gorgeous, gorgeous day. Yes.
Hear a little bit more about the study spaces, unless you're going to talk about later on.
I think we can talk a little bit about that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So my question in particular was, what kind of opportunities in those spaces do the students have to connect to the equipment you've gotten there? Is it just standard connections at a system that's in there? Do you guys have wall panels? Are there wireless projection devices at all?
Each one of the group study spaces has a 65-inch touchscreen.
Uh-huh.
Behind the touchscreen, it's got a resident PC computer.
Yeah.
So they can use, and then each room also comes with a wireless keyboard and mouse. So the student can use the computer that's in the room. So mm-hmm. if they don't have
okay,
a computer or whatever,
computer
they can do that. There's also a HDMI outlet and a cable on a control panel right next to it, so they can use that to connect. The rooms also have a wireless BYOD box to connect to. So if you just select that, use IP into it, and then you can connect to the display using that. And then the displays also have an integrated whiteboard. So you could just select it on the little touchscreen. You can select it on the panel, turns the display into a whiteboard, and then you can use your fingers for multi-touch and just turn it into like a whiteboard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
These rooms are actually controlled and scheduled by the School of Business, and they have help guides for the students on how to use it. But as I've gone around, I've seen all the scenarios that Brian mentioned. I've seen people using the resident PC, plugging in their laptop with an HDMI cable. I've also seen them using Extron ShareLink, which has become our campus standard mm-hmm. for BYOD because it works so well on our network. We have it in a lot of our OIT conference rooms, and it just seems to fill the bill. And, you know, we spent a little time looking at that, and we came upon that as the best solution for our campus situation. So these other pictures that we have here, outdoor entrance, you can see there a pyramid. And that was kind of cool, too. The pyramid was a new entrance area. One of the first problems we had with the pyramid was that some of the campus skateboarders saw the pyramid and decided that it would be a great place to do some skateboarding on. I don't think that has been a problem recently, but at the very, very beginning, they kind of had their eyes set on that. So.
They had to put bike racks at the bottom.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Those bike racks weren't there in the beginning.
Right there.
The
yeah. Yeah, that's right. So
win-win.
Yes, double strategy. So, and here's a shot, too, of some where you're finding people who are sitting at these high counter areas studying, often in the morning. I kind of run through the building on my way to Smith, and I'll see them there. They're plugging in their devices. There's power there, very important power. That's one of the things we learned on some of our other projects, that we did not have enough power, especially the Academic Student Rec Center. Our CIO at the time started looking around and she's like, where's the power? There's no power. And I think on a project like this, they got it right. The second project that's coming online, this, they created something very similar, but they didn't put the power on top so you could see it. They put the power underneath. So you're going to have to like, where's the power? Oh, there it is. Like, people will ask a lot of questions. Okay, let's see if I got it. Okay. So what worked on the project real quickly? So it really worked for us is that my unit had control of the owner-furnished budget. So, you know, you've heard owner-furnished and the vendor does the work. And this is what happened here. So given X amount of dollars, and we spent it all through OITC, contracts through Troxel, ClassTech, all our regular partners. So there was nobody really new or nothing new or exciting about this. It was already known. So a lot of the stuff that we needed for this project was already under state contract and was available through our vendors. Once again, these were the players, some of the big players we had, Panasonic, ClassTech, Extron, Vadio, and Daylight. You know, we've worked with these types of these products for a variety of years. These were the things we didn't want to deviate. We didn't have to deviate. We could go with our standard equipment deployments as much as we could, but yet, with projectors, kept thinking, this is the time to go to laser. It's time to leave the lamp behind. And this is the project that it began on. And from this point forward, unless there's a really, real compelling reason, we won't buy projectors with lamps. Unless there's a certain application, we have to have a projector with a lamp. This was done over three fiscal cycles also. It's very important to realize, 15, 16, 17. I won't say it seemed like it went quickly in that time, but everything seems like it's going quickly now. So, but it happened in a time period where we were able to really focus on it, and it was the first of, like I said, other projects. Key external partners who took ownership, and that was one of the things in my earlier slide that I tried to talk a little bit about, and I hope I can't emphasize enough. If this building was a success, it had to do with the success of everybody working together as a collective. The ownership that Skanska in particular, you know, I can think of the guy who was the construction site manager now and all the hard work he did, all the traffic direction they had to do because you're on a major intersection in Portland on Broadway and how they had to shut down the streets at different times and he would be out there directing traffic, always rolling his sleeves up, his right-hand person, left-hand person, rolling their sleeves up, going to that extra mile to make success. And it was true of everybody on that project, the other reason for great success on this and what worked well is the steering committee. Always meeting, always engaged. This is the vice presidents. These are the deans. This is the levels above us. And that really led to the success because they brought clarity to the project and direction. And you couldn't ask anything more from a steering committee on a project. We were engaged early in the process, early as 2013. I can remember attending meetings and hearing about different things related to this and the ramping up related to that, and conversations early on with some of the design team and the AV designer and what they were trying to do, looking at our existing spaces and what the goals were and what we were. So we were involved. And I think mentally our campus was really prepared for a project like this. We hadn't had any projects this big for quite a while. I think the last one is maybe the ASRC, and we had a Lincoln Hall renovation, but we were ready. The time was there. And then and the first key piece of changes to our campus involving major projects. This is project number one. Project number two got done about 2-3 weeks ago. And project number four now is going through some major remodel, or three is going through some major remodel, and four is in design right now, which is a brand new building. So, issues. I could have said problems, but I didn't want to say that. That sounded too negative for me, and that's not me. So let's talk about the issues. First was the change in the School of Business leadership, three times. So we started out with our existing dean, and then they hired a new dean. And then that dean left. And then a new dean came on, and that is our current dean, an engaged faculty member who used technology significantly. I can remember us working a lot with him in Echo 360 and doing things, and him being passionate about Google Hangouts and other technology uses. And when we started doing the demonstrations for the global classrooms, he was the one faculty member from the School of Business who attended each time. And I won't forget that. So that was a big piece, that changeover, and it did make a difference. Also, from a daily perspective, and I can speak to my colleagues here, is that you had to figure out how you're going to get around that space. Because it's like, okay, which sidewalk's going to be closed that's going to have to cause me to go a couple blocks in a different direction? You know, that's inconvenient, yeah, but we hadn't been inconvenienced that much before. Also, when they did, you saw them take the skybridge away. That caused some inconvenience, too. There was changes when the skybridge. You learn to adapt to it, but you have to realize that. Another one of the sad moments is that we lost one of our critical project staff members passed away during this process, who was essentially the project assistant to the project manager. And in that role, that's a critical role. That's the person who works with us to do a lot of the things to get us the information we need. We give them information. And on our ongoing projects, we couldn't exist without them. And to sadly lose somebody tragically like we did in this, it was tough. That was tough. It didn't slow things down, but it got everybody very emotional at this. Another thing that happened, and I think this happened during the summer of 2016, is that there was a very large tree right across the street from the building in Smith Center where it toppled. And how big a tree was it?
It was as tall as the student union.
Yeah, as tall as the student union. And it toppled and almost, you know, took out vehicles, took this. But that's one of the things, like, okay, did our project cause that tree to fall and crumble? Was it the weather? What was it? Speaking of weather, last year we had an uncharacteristic snowy, icy winter, and it did affect the project. So I would go into the project meetings, and I would hear the countdown. How many days are we behind now? And it would vary. It'd be, we're 12 days behind. We're 15 days behind. We're 18. We're back to 15. It varied because of some of the weather we were experiencing. And, you know, you lull yourself into a false sense of security about weather in a construction project. But in this case, we were looking at it very closely and going, oh no, the weather. And then one of the tougher situations, and I actually think I was out of town when it happened, was there was a major power failure in August of 2017, and it was due to failed testing. Brian, could you address that?
So was that when the sprinkler had?
Yes, that was the sprinkler.
So they were doing a test on the sprinkler system. It was supposed to open up that September. And the sprinkler system popped in one of the elevator shafts, and that flooded the power room in the basement of the building, which then caused the power to go out as the building's going to open in a month and a half, and now we don't have power to finish up a lot of these things, and that puts things in a conundrum.
Yeah.
blew out a major power bus, which was a proprietary component that had to be
rebuilt
from scratch and shipped to us and installed.
Yeah.
So everyone was so freaked out that
it wouldn't happen.
Half the building was without, was it five and six?
Five and six was when I had no power for like a week and a half, 2 weeks.
And people were moving into the building already. That was a nightmare.
That was a tough little time, but they did recover. Next item, scope creep. There's always project scope creep. It happened here. It actually kind of happened a little bit coming from the dean's office. Things like they asked for two monitors on our class tech podiums, which we have never done before, and that's because they wanted that. They thought that would be great to have confidence monitoring, the ability for two to PowerPoint on one and
extended displays.
So it caused the project more money than expected. So I would have been able to give them more money back, but I wasn't able to because of that. So, and always thinking of ways to, let's do this, Doug, let's do that, Doug, and you know, that's it. And then value engineering. There was some value engineering on this project, and they made a mistake too on the value engineering. They didn't quite get it right, so they put in a lot of additional infrastructure that they were going to value engineering out, but there was confusion with the project manager, so they just left it in, which in hindsight now is really good they left it in, because now we don't have to go back and add power and data anywhere in certain locations. So it's just there, it's just not activated, and it's good. But sometimes you overvalue engineer, and we found out about a few weeks ago what overvalue engineering is. They took out some Linel, which is door control, on the boardroom, on two different doors on both sides. That was supposed to happen, got value engineered, nobody thought twice about it. Well, they started letting people use the room into the evenings and not having a locking, unlocking plan with a keyed lock. Well, at some point, maybe around spring break, somebody got in the room and did some damage to the Panasonic touchscreens in the room, like scratch them like that, and they're damaged here and damaged there. One of my staff went over to investigate it and found that perhaps a homeless person had been living in the space over the weekend. They found a cachet of clothes and a toothbrush and other things like that. So it's like, yeah, you probably should have put Linel on it to protect yourself. And they are going to go back and put Linel on it. And now they close the room at 6 o'clock at night and don't let anyone use it after that. So another lesson learned. So some of the outcomes associated with the project that we're seeing right now. It sets the bar higher. Since we did a great job on this building, the university did a very good job on this building, the expectations around our Viking Pavilion, the expectations around the Neuberger Hall remodel, the expectations around the 4th and Montgomery building are going to be higher now. And that means technology, that means money, that means opening up buildings to bring more light in and make them more user-friendly spaces. When we can work together, we can accomplish a lot. And we did work together well, and you know, this was a nice check on that list of check-off things that you want to do. It went from being the least student-centric building on campus to the most centric building on campus. We can walk through there and see literally 150, 200 students kind of sprinkled around between the different floors. We could see people doing different things and having fun and just engaging themselves. The campus retail, and Brian has a brief story about that.
So it was brought to my attention. So we got several retail areas. One of them is already open. One of them is a local donut shop. This building is co-located across the street from our public safety office. Coincidence?
Yeah.
I leave that for you to decide.
Yeah. The project delivered the expected outcomes that I believe the university had. These rooms are popular. People are using them within the School of Business first, because that's the rule, because they have a share, so they get first right of refusal. But there are others who are like, ooh, I want to teach in there too. I want to do some more things. I mean, I was instrumental in moving a engineering class in there for the transportation seminar, and they're like, it's a good thing it's on a Friday, Doug, because it wouldn't have happened if it wasn't on a Friday. So, yeah. Highly functional space, and by that I mean it's in use. And that I think is the most exciting thing for me, to see a space that's used by students for studying, coming together as teams, just hanging out with their friends, just doing a little bit of everything. We've got an OIT managed computer lab there. We took over the responsibilities of their daily operations of their computer lab for them, because we have a really good track record of good lab management with our team that does that. And that has been successful too. And we have a person who's probably sitting there right now at the desk outside the building. And we actually took a couple lessons from what they did here at OSU and how they put their computer lab in. So it's like, okay, just put a person out in the hallway. And it does work, and it's very nice. And then the other thing that kind of shocked us and surprised us a little bit, well, there was an atrium area, and you guys saw the pictures of the atrium area. It was a value engineer to take out the giant daylight screen that we had spec'd out for it, or to bring in a projector or a resident house system. It has turned out to be a hugely popular space for events on campus. So one of the issues related to that that's caused some problems, that people want to play loud music when finals are going on. People want to have announcements when other things are going on, and it's like this. So they're working out their plans on how they're going to handle the scheduling of the space, because at sometimes we just cannot have events going on there, and everybody has to come in agreement. And so we're working now with some of the administrators at the university and the dean's office to get that figured out. All right, a few more pictures, a classroom, a night shot, and kind of looking down there at what we have. So thank you guys very much. It's been a pleasure giving this presentation. And any questions? It's a wrap. Oh yeah, I got Met money. who's collecting?
I don't know.
Okay.